Okay, I think it's already 12:16, so I'm going to start the presentation. First of all, welcome everybody. Welcome to ApacheCon and the Cassandra track. My name is Ekaterina. I'm a software engineer at DataStax, and I work on Cassandra since last year. Today, we are going to talk about how to get involved in the Apache Cassandra project. So let's get started. So first, the outline of today's talk. First, I'm gonna express a couple of, I'm sorry, I got distracted by David here. So first, we are gonna talk who are you and who are the potential new contributors to the project. Then I'm gonna say a couple of words around the ASF structure and Cassandra project. Of course, where to start, because this is the main question, I believe, for everyone who would like to start contributing to a project. And then we'll discuss a little bit the different contributions and the way to approach them. So who are you, or who do I think you are? First of all, Cassandra users. Yes, they are still contributors in many ways. Cassandra users could be individual, contributors, individual users, or even companies. I think during these days, you saw during the different sessions, presenters from different companies who contribute in different way, even by just making a talk in front of you for Cassandra and different use cases or developments in Cassandra. You saw the program already. You can be also someone who is looking for a side project. You know, these days we stay quite a lot at home. So because of pandemic and other disasters this year, unfortunately, but yeah, not everyone is interested in watching films all the time. Some people want side projects, cool as Cassandra, or you are just an enthusiastic person who is really interested on how this works. You heard that your favorite shows on Netflix are the Netflix service is using probably Cassandra, and also other services that you use on data on a daily basis. So probably you would like to see how the things work, contribute, do stuff, play a bit around. So about Cassandra users, Cassandra users, why they would be interested to be contributors, and in what way? Because when we talk about contributors, one important thing is many people think it's only about coding, but the thing it's not only about coding. Contributions happen in many different ways. Even some companies donate hardware to some projects, which is a quite good contribution for an open source project, which is a lot of volunteer work involved. So back to the Cassandra users, you might be an experienced user using Cassandra for many years, who was using a lot of things there, but you are still not sure how do they work, and your interest comes here and you're like, I want to know more. I would like to actually see how they work. Or there is some bug that was bothering you and you want to at least provide us feedback about it, so you would like to file Jira, or you might want even to work on it and contribute the fix. Or you might have also a great idea to improve your life, and others could also benefit of that. So that's a good contribution too. And when we talk about contributions and feedback, let's be honest, there is no bad feedback. Even when you provide some, maybe some information that people wouldn't want to hear, like things that don't really go well or don't work well, this is again a good feedback, because after all, the goal of everyone is to make the project good for its users. So every feedback is greatly appreciated. As a user, you might also have some valuable use case that it could be worth it to share with the world. So a great contribution in this case would be to write a blog post, for example, at our webpage, or maybe to give a talk at ApacheCon, as many people did these days. And I found them very interesting talks for myself. You might want also to do a workshop. People are experienced with different cases, like different upgrades and stuff, and not everything is easy always. So it might be good if you want to share your experience with others and give some experienced advice on how the things would work better or in a nice way. I'm sorry, again, I'm disturbed by some colleagues here. Yeah, David, you. So, as I mentioned at the beginning, users are not individual users, and contributors are not just individual users. I guess you won't be surprised, as we already seen the representatives of some of those companies. I just put a couple of them here, but there are many, many companies actually who are interested in open source. Why, to what extent, this is a topic of another talk probably, but worth it to mention that a lot of companies are involved there and contributions can happen in many different ways. So we said another group of contributors could be people looking for side projects. Who are those people actually? It might be a student, you know. There are students who are working on projects during their studies, but they're like, yeah, when I apply for a job, when I graduate, actually, they always ask me for experience. And what experience? I show what I'm doing, what I was doing at school, that's great. But if I have the experience of working on some nice open source project, involved working on different topics, which are probably topics that are important for big companies and interesting use cases, and you can prove yourself through those projects and your work there that you really know what you are doing, that's a good start. I find it nice for students. Another area, another group of people is researchers. Nowadays, many PhD students or researchers or even companies or in NSF, many people base their research on different open source projects or different in general software and stuff, and they come up with very interesting findings sometimes. So it's interesting those people to share and in some cases even contribute what they are doing to the project. So this is another group of people who might contribute in a different way, or even just share their experience and maybe just discuss whether something is feasible. That's also a good thing. Engineers, of course, they are always interested in such kind of projects. And normally when we talk about contributions, people always say coding and engineers. Well, it's not always the case, and I can't say that these are the most important and the only important contributions. Every contribution, no matter what, is important in open source. As, let's be honest, a lot of the work there is done voluntarily. Even people who work full time, sometimes they are so much into those projects that they dedicate a lot of their time from the weekends or after work, just because it's a lot of interest there. Or you can be just looking for a new hobby and to tackle some new technologies, algorithms, or interesting problems, and you would like to dedicate some of your personal time. That's a great thing always. Troublemakers, we love them here. Why? Well, probably you heard we have Cassandra for All. Beta version is already out, And it's quite important there to get the user's feedback. Feedback in all senses. Please, if you have an environment, test Cassandra environment already set up and use cases, please try to test it on the for all beta. Provide us with feedback. As I said, there is no bad feedback. All feedback is appreciated, even if we don't like it, and it means that there will be more work to be done. This is good for, it will be good also for you in the future as being our user. So we love troublemakers. We love them to test. We love them to check the documentation even, probably help with different patches or even reviews of tickets, all kind of things that you might imagine. All help will be highly appreciated. And as I said, enthusiastic person, just probably this overlaps a bit with the hobby and the other users. But yes, let's be honest, on the open source project, there are a lot of people who are really interested into particular problems and particular software. And they dedicate a lot of their energy from their free time, and they are quite enthusiastic. And I would like to say that this is highly applicable for Cassandra. I haven't seen anyone who is really just doing it just because he was. He's only made, most of the people have some interest. And an interesting, actually, an interesting point for me is that actually this is how I chose my work last year. I was interested into the project. Next on the line, we'll talk a bit about ASF and Cassandra structure. How it works, I have provided here this link for you, so there are way more details that you can get acquainted with. But on high level, this is the pyramid, the structure that you would see. I would like to say that normally people say, yeah, contributors are developers. I think contributors are all the people here. Users are also contributors. Very often, people who are experienced are responding to our users, to other users' questions or helping to tackle different problems. And this is a great contribution because it's important to be able to support our users. And while, for example, developers are tackling interesting or critical problems, it would be great if there is someone who can support them by providing support on the different communication channels to our users. Or just, as I said, doing workshops, testing, and other stuff. Developers, they are not committers, but I can't say that they are less important than the committers. Yes, the difference, of course, is that there is trust there in the committers, and they are experienced seasonal contributors to the project. But these are the first steps in order to get higher on the list. Still, committers are more associated with short-term decisions, and the people who are dealing with the long-term decisions on a project and supporting the committers and have the option to put a veto on what's going on are the PMC or Program Management Committee, which is something common for most of the project. Trusted people who are taking the biggest decisions and who are the primary on a project. So this is just high-level information. As I said, if you want some more information on the structure, the Apache Software Foundation webpage provides a lot of good information there and different definitions, which you might want to get acquainted with if you haven't been already exposed to them. So the main question, how to become a contributor? Where should I start? Like, Cassandra is by no means an easy software. The code is huge. There are a lot of topics there, a lot of things. So where should I start? Well, I have some good news for you today. Actually, currently we have on our webpage, we have contributing to Cassandra section, where you can find a lot of useful information. But I would like also to point out here, for those of you who are not following these days our Slack channels or the mailing lists, there were a lot of discussions around new contributions and how we can support new contributors. in order to help them to speed up with what they do and to give them guidance. So please stay tuned. I believe that there will be a lot of new and good stuff and a lot of opportunities and options to get involved in this really nice project, which I truly believe in. Contributing to Cassandra, this is an excerpt from that section that I just pointed to. So contributions can happen in many ways. It's not only coding, as I mentioned already. You can contribute to documentation, to the quality assurance, testing, helping other users, or new features, bugs, dealing with bugs, reviews and tests of submitted patches. There are a lot of stuff that you can do. I believe that there is something for everyone who is interested there. So not everything is coding. As I already mentioned, we have here on our webpage the community section where you can find information about users list, developers mailing list, and also Slack channels, the general Cassandra user channel, and Cassandra dev. I also like Stack Overflow because the nice thing about it is that you can find easily previous questions that were already responded, and there is the uploading, which I find really useful. So whoever is experienced and can share different responses to the questions, or if you are not experienced in everything but you had something and you know already the answer, always appreciate it if you can help. It's really nice to see that people's questions are responded in 1-2 hours, because let's be honest, if you have a problem and you are dealing with something and if it's your business, not just testing at home, probably you would like to get some answers and some guidance, not in a week or two, but way more often, way faster. What else? So you can contribute to our documentation. I believe there is detailed information how this can happen, again, in that section that I mentioned. You can always also write a blog post, give a talk, or make a workshop. And back to the documentation, here you can see even on our webpage, this documentation is work in progress. Also, one thing I'm thinking about, you know how often when we work on something, we kind of get used to it. You work on it all the time, it looks obvious, you put down some instruction for the user, and it's not that it's bad, but maybe it can skip some details that are obvious for you, but not for someone who is brand new. So it will be nice if someone comes and starts reading and says, oh, by the way, here you have something to improve, or it didn't work exactly the way I felt it there, and we are getting feedback. So this is quite important. I believe it's quite important contribution. We had people lately who were trying to help us there, which we highly appreciate. So yes, please try to help us also in that direction. But I really, really want to code, right? Yeah, many people want, yes. And then you go to that page and you see this table and you say, that's it. It means, what is code freeze? Like, how I'm going to contribute to coding? What's this coding like? What's code freeze? Like, what should I do? And you are puzzled. Well, I have some good news for you. That sounds a bit weird, but it's not really an issue, and you can still do a lot of things, and you can still start thinking about new features, improvements, and stuff. So let's dig a bit more into this. First, of course, as we said that we are in beta version, bug fixing is with priority. As probably you heard, the goal of the project is to have the most stable version of Cassandra. So you can go and check in our Jira what are the current issues or something that you discovered already. You might want to check there whether it's already submitted as an issue, or you can submit on your own, or you can, if it is already submitted, you can always also just add a bit more information from your use case if you find that that might be helpful. Or you can help with the patch. Highly appreciated. You can also review submitted patches. Okay, maybe you are not an expert in some parts of the code base, but even just to test the patch and to say, I had some findings, this sometimes can speed up the process. Also, it's a good way for new contributors to learn new stuff and wrap up their mind around the code base. So I I'm sorry again, I got disturbed from my colleagues. Review submitted patches, as I said. So another thing is tests. Testing. It happens a lot these days. It will happen even more, and we will see a lot of things going on in the next month or two because we approach GA, and that's quite important. So if you feel like you can improve some existing ones, write new ones, or even work on some performance improvements, that will be also amazing. It will be highly appreciated. So that's another opportunity. And as I promised, code freeze doesn't mean that you can't work on new things. That is quite an important point. How? Well, I'll tell you in a minute. It's about the CEPs, existing ones and new ones. What is CEP? This is Cassandra Enhancement Proposal. It's actually kind of pre-work before the actual work, but it's quite important. Why? This is a proposal of something new that you would like to create, work on, or donate from your code base if you've been working on something on the site, which is on top of Cassandra. And that's a way to discuss it with other people, to find out early whether it's feasible. If you haven't started yet, you can discuss it with other people. Or you can find already submitted CEPs and you might be interested to work on them or to put some discussion out there, to be involved. And that's a great thing. This doesn't mean that everything until the end will work out the way it was stated at the beginning, but it's a good start. And the code freeze doesn't mean that you can't start with this. Here I published on the slide a link where you can see how the CEPs work. There is certain structure which you need to follow when you submit a CEP. You can see also the existing ones, which can give you some kind of direction, what people expect and how this works. All kind of objections could start and could be handled early in the process. So this is really a good thing, and it's an instrument, technical difficulties to be discovered really early. But there is one quite important thing. Please don't start, don't initiate a CEP if you don't have the capability and the intention to complete it. This is a serious thing. And it requires time, it's time consuming. And as we mentioned, it's open source, so everyone dedicates time on it. And it will be good for both you and the people involved in the project if we get involved and distracted only by things that will really work out. If you just have a random small idea and you are wondering whether to initiate a SEP, this is also a good thing, is also to jump into some of the Slack channels or someone you get to know from the project and say, by the way, does this make sense? Like, how do you feel about it? What do you think? So be serious about that, as it's important and it's time consuming. I see a question in Slack. Okay. Do you have a label for Jira issues? I'll talk about this in the next few slides. So that's a very good question. I'll come back to this in a minute. Contributions. Here is where we are gonna mention the Jira issues and how to approach them if we want to pick up something like to choose what to work on. Before you start coding, there are some things that are good to know. When you are trying to figure out what to work on, if you don't have an exact idea and you just want to jump into Jira and see what kind of things people work on these days and try to find out that something that is already raised and you might be able to help with, but also you are not sure exactly where to start, maybe you don't know the code base really well, you are just starting, well, then we have some recommendations for you. Some things are mentioned already on the web page, but as I said, we work also on new labels and new ways to handle this. So please stay tuned. This will get better and better, I promise. But important things to stress on now. So first, if you are not looking for an open Jira to work on, but you want to submit a Jira on your own, please check that there is not already work submitted there. If it's not submitted, feel free to create it. But it's good also, if you are not sure about something, to check in our Slack channels. That is quite fast way, or on the mailing list, of course. That is a good way to check whether something is feasible or not, and whether it's really an issue, and how people feel about working on that. A good way to find Jira tickets to work on. This is just an example. It's not that you should follow exactly this filter. It's just an example and some kind of baseline for you. So there is, first you might want to select, of course, the project Cassandra, but then there are different types of issues. There are bugs, tasks, improvements. Currently the project is focused because of our role on bugs, so that's a good point to start if you really want to be noticed and people to help you, because this is where most of the energy goes to. You can check by open, fixed version. Of course, here I put just 4.0, but this doesn't mean that you can't work also on stuff on other versions. And complexity, that's the point that was important and that I believe was bothering the people in the channel, in the chat. Low-hanging fruit. This means that these are small tickets with something that is not really hard, and that someone who is new, probably sometimes with guidance, sometimes without, will be able to handle. So it's a good way to start. I would say probably you would like to check whether there is an assignee already, but also heads up, sometimes people start doing something, but some other priority comes up, or they're doing voluntary this work and something just grabbed their attention, or something happened at home and they didn't manage to finish it. So some tickets look like no one is working on them. This might be the case, but might be also that it's not the case. So it's good if you jump and say, by the way, I saw there was no update like the last month or two. So do you mind if I start working on this? I have that idea. Do you need some help? That's also a good option. Other important things, please, when you work on a Jira issue, try to constantly provide some updates there and say what you are doing. Maybe you can even share a work in progress branch and show what you're doing so you can get feedback. Also, the smaller the patch, actually the better, because it's easier to grab the attention of a committer who doesn't have a lot of time, but it's a small patch and he can do it in between. If you submit a patch with 5,000 lines, well, I'm sorry. I'm not sure that this will be really fast handled. So that's a good thing. Also, you might want to consider different commits for one Jira issue, like different stage on the work that you are doing. Also, you can try to ping people for advice. They'll be always happy to help. The communication is a bit asynchronous because people are located all over the world, but this shouldn't bother you. At some point, you'll get a response, or if they're busy, they'll just let you know. That's why I'm saying it's always better to ask your questions in the channel instead of pinging people directly, because they respond to you. But if you want a really fast response, probably in the channel, whoever is not that busy at that moment will be able faster to respond to you. Good thing to get acquainted with is the code style convention also. There is a link here. Also, the review guidelines. We'll talk about this in a minute. Still no coding. What does this mean? Still no coding? Well, yes, I put an emoji. Why? Because it's serious, but not that scary. So you might want to get to know the contributor license agreement and to fill it. This is not something scary, as I said, but it's good to know. I think it's a requirement currently for committers, but in general, it should be used also by just developers, contributors who are not committers. So here is the link, get acquainted with it. I believe there are separate talks for this. This is something that is applicable for all open source projects. It's not something specific for Cassandra project. So just a heads up, get acquainted with it. I believe that most of the companies, when you work for a company where you you are coding, probably the lawyers there will already know when we talk about intellectual property, what's going on and what is needed. So nothing scary. Hooray, submitting Apache. You did an amazing job and you would like to submit it and to get feedback and of course to be committed, right? That's why we work. We are like, we want our work to be out there for the people. Well, detailed instructions are on the web page, but there are a couple of things that I would like to mention now. Like, for example, a common practice is to have a fork with a branch to work on for a specific patch. You can also submit patches. You can also share just branches on a Jira ticket. Merge puffing case. So we know that there are bugs which might be specific to a specific branch version, because the versions of Cassandra are on different branches, as you can see here. But there might be also bugs which were introduced earlier and they are still applicable and we need to fix them in all branches, in all versions. So it's good to know in advance what you are looking for, which branch you should tackle, where is the problem exactly. If you need help for this, please feel free to contact us. Code style, I already mentioned it. It's good, as you know, it's a common structure for everyone. This makes the code way more comprehensible. New tests, ensure that your code is really tested and working. If there is no test in place for the particular program, introduce new ones. And last but not least, run CI to ensure that nothing got broken. If currently we have Jenkins used as an official CI for the project, but also there is an option to use Circle CI. This information and how to set them up is on the website again. If you can't submit a CI, please, again, contact us. We'll be happy to help you. Unfortunately, some of the tests are a bit heavy and it will be really hard to run everything on your machine. Also, the official Jenkins is only for committers, but they are always happy to submit a patch and to test it there. But you can still test at least those tests which are applicable for the work you were doing locally to ensure that you are good. Full instructions about that part are on our webpage. So Circle CI is free. Still, it can't. There are some restrictions with the free tier there. So maybe you won't be able again to run the complete set of tests, but a big amount of them could be run there. So you can try to get acquainted with that or ask. We'll be happy to share with you how to do that. Important is to put an entry about what you're working on in changes.txt. It's just a description and Jira ticket, what was done. And please get acquainted with the review checklist because it makes our lives easier, both for you and for us. Because, you know, you go there and you check in advance what is needed. So you can, when checking there, you're like, oh yeah, I missed that. So this kind of reminds you for some stuff. It gives you a guideline what we are looking for, and you are able to reach easier that wanted moment and the goal, your work to be committed, really. And you save time for people, both for you and the others. Also, as I said, we are dispersed all over the place, around the world, different time zones. So if you submit something and the people check it and then they have only the time to get to check it again next weekend, well, time flies. It will be easier and faster if you can check some stuff in advance. And it's a good guideline for someone to start with. As I said, you can submit either a branch or a patch, a link in your Jira ticket. Good practice to squash your commits post-review before a commit. So I was thinking maybe of a demo, but I don't think we'll have enough time to check in Jira, but I would be happy at any time to support anyone and to go through steps in Jira on the different tickets and talk about that. So feel free to reach out. And in conclusion today, I would like to provide a general advice for everyone. As we just saw, there are many, many ways to contribute to a project. A lot of people work on this. They have different backgrounds. They have different jobs, different life situation even. You see now with COVID and everything, you have kids at home. So everyone is kind of overwhelmed. But don't get discouraged if there is some argument or something doesn't work the way you would like it. Everyone has the same goal, to make Cassandra great. And I feel that actually the times when there are arguments or we aim to do something better, which we say, oh, this is great, but let's change it. This is actually for our goodness, and this is kind of the pulse of the project, because we invest from ourselves, we invest more time, and we try to raise the bar and to make it better. And it's not like, you know, you don't have particular deadlines from people for some certain stuff to happen. So this makes it possible to rewrite it a couple of times until you do it really great. And having a lot of people there and anyone can jump into it, this really makes it more possible for rewrites to be requested, which is a good thing. Don't take it personal. But don't forget, we are all here. Questions are highly appreciated. Rewrites happen even for the best engineers, because there are people with a lot of different background and a lot of things going on. So just welcome, enjoy, don't take anything personal, and know that we all have the same goal, we all work on the same stuff, and even if something is not immediately accepted in a way, this doesn't mean it's not great. So I hope that this talk was useful for you. And if you have any questions now or in the future, please feel free to contact me. I'll be happy to support you as everyone else on the project. Okay, let's check what questions might be out there. Guidelines on how to set up the project, set up run tests on CI and test locally. We have some guidelines, but I believe that maybe it would be a good point if someone can make a tutorial or something with more things. I might even think about it. That's a good point. Any particular questions? Jira label, we set the low hanging fruit. No questions? Okay. As I said, I hope it was useful. I hope to see you on the project soon, to talk to every one of you. And have a wonderful rest of the day. I believe this was the first session, so enjoy the next sessions in our track. I'm sure that there will be something for everyone. Goodbye.